Good evening to one and all. Myself, Mrs. Saili Gupte from Mangrove Foundation. As you all are aware that currently we are fighting a unique battle against the coronavirus by staying at indoors. We thought to invest this time in public awareness through a webinar of Marine Matter Lecture Series. In order to reach out the general public, the Mangrove Foundation launched this Marine Matter Lecture Series in 2019 and have been getting an overwhelming response for it since the inception. Today we are attending the 9th chapter of this lecture series. Now I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Sheetal Pasupande. She has completed her PhD in mangroves and is currently working as an assistant director of projects in Mangrove Foundation. She will be leading us today to this virtual tour of mangroves. But before we start this session, I would like to request you all to kindly shut down the videos of your meeting so that you will get a good bandwidth and the presentation will go smooth. Now I would like to request Dr. Sheetal to take over the session.
Hello all. I'm Sheetal. I'm very well introduced by Saili. I have been studying and understanding various perspectives about mangroves since past 12 years. And it was my first visit in the year 2008 that made me fell in love with them. And I always had found mangroves as altogether a different world where you get to see the complex structures that are formed and very beautifully arranged in the nature. And I'm really excited to describe all my experiences with you all. Are you all also excited? So let me tell you that the mangroves is a very really exciting ecosystem. But before that, let me ask you to think that whether do you really know about mangroves? Did it sound to you like mangoes? It used to sound the same to people when I used to study them. It was only when it was described well to the people or then they used to think mangroves as different from the mangroves. And I know by today you might have little idea about what actually the mangroves are due to the growing awareness in the public. As we all see, every year there is this seasonal disturbances, then there's this flooding, and there are a lot of articles that keep coming in public and media because of which we know some of the glimpses of the mangroves. So I know by today you might have this little idea and what they are actually due to growing awareness in the public media. And now let us concentrate, before we go through this virtual tour of mangroves, do you really know what mangroves are? And in short, to describe mangroves, they are the species which are neither found on the land nor on the sea. As you can see here in the illustration, this is the area, there is a sea, there is a land, and this is the zone where you see these different trees. Every tree is different. At the base of the tree, you can see different type of root system, which are very different than we had always seen. Then now I would like to ask you that do you remember something watching like this? Now I believe that today in this webinar there might be people who must be knowing mangroves, there might be people who are very new to the topic. So people who are new to the topic, so maybe have you seen something like this? Or maybe when you are driving along the sides of the road or while you are on the holiday for a trip, from the train, from the bus, from the car window, you might have come across this dense green thick patches. And if you are leaving your Mumbai, Navi Mumbai or Thane, this is quite a familiar view. Now, are you surprised that after understanding this, this is what you have been seeing through all, from so many years? So I think the webinar that we are having today, and that I'm sure that it will take you one step closer to this ecosystem where you will feel understanding more about this ecosystem. So now, before that, even though, like, you know, they occupy a very small coverage on the planet Earth, as you can see here in the map, all these green lines or borders that you can see are the mangroves. So looking at that expanse, it is really a very small area that is being covered by the mangroves. And still, depending on the fate of human life, mangroves are extremely important, and they play a very important role in protecting the land from the erosion, as you can see in the world map over here. And also, they are just located in this tropical and subtropical areas and along the boundaries of the land. So even though they occupy a very small expanse of the land, they form a complete ecosystem. Even if there is a very small mangrove patch, it is a complete ecosystem. It has its own unique type of trees, unique, unusual type of organisms. They are also equally adapted to as how mangroves are. We will just see like how mangroves are adapted. So mostly, like, you know, this mangroves, they live in the highly saline condition. They are frequently inundated with the water. The soil over here is anaerobic, that is, it lacks oxygen. And talking about some of the organism, I am sure that many of you must be knowing crabs, and crab is also a delicacy in many places over here. So after looking at this life cycle or this food chain, we can see that there here is a crab, and crabs play a very important role in forming the detritus, as you can see here. And can you see that how this detritus has attracted all these life forms around it? So now we can think that why crabs are important, what can be their role in the environment. And if you observe them minutely, they are one of the wonders that nature has created, who can do this enormous work of shredding the mangrove leaf litter without electricity. And thus, they are also the starter of the food chain. Like, that is how the food chain has started over here. And also, one thing is, like, do you know, like, where do they live? Though they are engineers, they don't build their houses on the ground, but they make one inside the ground. They take the leaves down into the mud, helping in some sort of aeration that is created in that muddy substrates. Nutrients addition is done for further growth of new mangrove species, and the environment is made very favorable for the growth of various species that are found in this environment. As you can see, even in this image, there are some shells, some bivalves, and there are many more microscopic organisms that are thriving over here. So one thing I like about this ecosystem is that so all this factor make this ecosystem a very highly productive ecosystem, and it has abundant food supply for every organism that becomes part of this unique ecosystem. And all these mangroves, like, you know, you wherever, like, you visit any of the coastal areas or the coastal boundaries, we see this green thicket of mangroves. Throughout the world, there are around 70 to 80 different type of mangrove species. And also at the west coast of Maharashtra, we have a good species diversity of 20 mangrove species. Now, it is really surprising to understand that how this mangrove species escaped from the competition of growing on a very stable land, and they became the member of this very unstable land where life is very challenging, and they have to face all the nature extremes and calamities that comes from the sea. They are, like, always bold and beautiful, protecting our coastlines. This image, from this image also, you can see, like, you know, there are different type of leaf in each canopy. So this is one, then two, three, sorry, four and five. So from all these canopies, like, you know, you can see that every species is different. It has its own everything are like, you know, something that will help us also to understand and differentiate this species more in a more better way. Now, what do you think that is most amazing that you notice when you see the mangrove? Now, there is a picture of a huge tree in front of you. This is a mangrove tree. And of course, I'm sure it is the root system, right? So, have you seen this type of roots before? This type of roots, maybe you might have seen the banyan tree or something, but this roots are very different. Like, you know, they are present only at the base, above the waterline. So, this type of roots are called as stilt roots. And journey of their formation is very magnificent. Now, let us see how these roots are formed above ground. And the one you can see in the image are the most common type of roots that you will see in the mangroves. Now, we were just discussing the journey of formation of this root. Now, this is the small portion of the same tree where you are able to see the leaves, and you can see the pod-like structures or green stick-like structures which are coming out. Now, these are not the roots, but these are the tiny saplings of the mangroves that are germinated on the mother plant itself. Now, just think for a while. Looking at the condition, looking at the sediment over there, looking at the daily like tidal influence, since the area is flooded every day twice by the water, it is very difficult for any species to sustain in that area. So some of the species have adapted themselves so that they will germinate the tiny saplings on the parent plants itself. So these are actually the roots, and as they attain the proper size and develop on them some breathing pores. Breathing pores, I mean a small dot, like, you know, which will allow the air to get inside, and then they are ready for the incredible journey. So now what you can see here is a tiny sapling which might have fallen down. So usually what happened, like, you know, the sapling, it will fall maybe just next to the parent tree, or maybe it will travel with the tides to find the perfect place for anchorage. Further, it starts producing the secondary and tertiary roots that you can see. So this is the primary root. These are the secondary roots. And this cycle goes on for years together to form the huge structure that we saw over here in this photo. The proper scientific name of the species is Rhizophora mucronata. Don't worry, I won't take you into the technicalities of the scientific names and all. But just an interesting fact is, like, about this name is, rhizo means roots and fora means the leaves. And here you can clearly see the leaves that are present on the root. So rhizophora. Mucronata, because every leaf will have a small needle-like tip or needle-like structure at its apex. And that shape is referred as mucronae. I hope this is not very difficult. So this is one of the species that is found also on the coastline of Maharashtra and throughout the India. So another common type of roots that we often get to see in the mangrove environment, they look something like this. So do they look like sharp, like pointed pencils to you? Yeah. So only they are called as pencil-like roots or breathing roots. One more thing that can be highlighted here in this picture or in this photo is, can you see the sediment, how densely or how compact it is? So there is hardly any place, like, you know, for oxygen to enter in. That is why, like, these soils are always anaerobic. They lack oxygen, and it develops a lot of pressure on these plants to adapt and to develop these type of roots by which they can overcome their problems. And so this root starts growing vertically upward, in vertically upward direction against the gravity. These are usually seen in the mangrove species, which is called as gray mangrove or Avicennia marina. It is also called as Tivar in Marathi. Now, I would like to show you some magic of their adaptation. You see the tree in one location, even if it is the same tree, not necessary, it will look similar when you go to the other location. Now here, what you are able to see is a dense forest of Avicennia Marina. This was clicked in Mumbai in the Gurai area. So where you can see this pencil-like breathing roots that are growing in upward direction, also called as pneumatophores, and the full-grown Avicennia trees. Now what will you say about this? This is also a full-grown tree, but this is growing on an island near Palenje in Raigad area. And because of the more influence of sand, we can as well see the horizontal roots that are growing on top of the substrate. So this is how like the roots in the Avicennia Marina or this type of species grow. Like they will form this type of horizontal roots, and then that horizontal roots will further grow this type of vertical outgrowths, which are called as breathing roots. And also here, the expanse of horizontal roots will be much wider compared to any other area. Also, this is how the trees adapt themselves depending on the climatic situation. So in this image, you can see that the mangroves are very stunted in the right side image. And these changes are because of the climatic factors. Now, what can be the climatic factors? It can be anything. It can be the flow and intensity of the tides, the substrate where it is growing, depth by which the plants are all these are the factors by which they can sense, what is it like that will make them survive. And accordingly, they change themselves and adapt themselves continuously. So for a layman, definitely these two will seem as different species. But once you start observing the species more closely, you will see that there is not much difference in the leaf, in the flower, in the fruit, which are same in every species, whether it is tall or whether it is dwarf. So this is how, even if the same species, it will exhibit the differences in the appearance. And both of them are the full-grown Avicennia Marina trees. So this type of adaptation can be seen even in this species, which we discussed just now, is Rhizophora mucronata. So now here the soil is muddy, so you can see how the root system is. But as you go to some areas, sometimes these trees are found near the beach area like Andamans. So here you will see the Rhizophora tree. Can you see the roots, how woody, how thick they are? And also in this image, you can see the roots have started growing from the top, not only at the base. Because maybe the tree has grown in height, it has to survive the strong winds, it has made its own adaptation to survive. There is one more tree, one more photo. Here also you can see how the leaves are, the roots have become very strong and woody to survive in this harsh conditions. So as per the habitat, all these mangrove species have the tendency to exhibit some or the other changes. So as you observe more, it will become very easy to understand about this mangrove species. Now one more interesting thing about this mangroves is, some of the mangrove leaves, you will always notice that they are covered with this type of white spots on the leaf. Now, you will be also surprised to know that this is number one purification technology in which the pure salt is extracted or excreted from the leaf surface. So, yes, this white tiny spots are nothing but the tiny salt crystals. These leaves have small openings on its surfaces. The people from the botany background might be knowing they are called as stomatas. So from the stomatas, they give out this tiny droplets which evaporates and concentrates into pure salt crystals. Now this is a salt which you will not get at any kind of store or a shop. You will get to see only in the mangroves. So it is very important to observe this amazing details the nature has created here in the mangrove ecosystem. many of us, like, you know, we stay miles away from this ecosystem, but still this is a fact that there is something very important about this ecosystem, and this ecosystem is very important for our own survival, whether we are part of it or whether we are not part of it. So I'm sure till class 10 we have studied the photosynthesis, where we all know that plants take in carbon dioxide from water with the help of sunlight. They take in carbon dioxide from the air, and with the help of sunlight and water they make food. And as we also know that this CO2 is a very harmful pollutant. So in a way, mangroves are really blessing to all of us, because they have this tendency to take tons and tons and tons of CO2 in their leaves, in their stem, in their roots, and eventually in their sediment. They are the richest carbon bank reserve than any other temperate or boreal forest. Scientists have also predicted that they have 40 times more capacity to store carbon in them. So probably the air we breathe continuously, the purification of this air is done maximum by the mangroves, especially for the people like us, like who live in the cities of Mumbai, Navi Mumbai, and nearby areas. So thus, if we can do, like, whatever little we can do for this wonderful ecosystem will probably bring more happiness to our lives. And in fact, it is also a blessing to the nearby communities, as they protect the villages from storms, surges, strong waves, and other natural calamities that come from the sea. Now here in the image, as you can see, there is a land parcel. There is a sea water with strong waves that is coming in, and here there are these mangroves standing very firmly, and they are trying to abat the sea waves and protecting the nearby villages that are present over here. So they have a very important role in protecting land, and it is the only ecosystem probably that connects the man with the sea in n number of ways. And not only man, but it also connects n number of species that reside on the land and on the sea. And there are many species like which stays and lives here maybe for a certain period of time. Many of us might be knowing that during what happens during high tide is there, this big fish from the sea, they often migrate, or they often come to this mangrove areas. Now, since mangrove has the dense canopy, and because of that, what happens, because of the cooler temperature and abundant food, this fish, they lay their eggs, and then the little babies are hatched over here, they grow, and again they go back to the sea. So mangroves are always a part, important part of the entire ocean ecosystem, and also for the land ecosystem as well. So it connects and the biodiversity around with them. Now, for example, a very small tiny virus has made the world complete standstill. Nothing is moving, death is around the corner, and you must be thinking that why am I discussing coronavirus situation over here? But this is to think. Think what? That maybe due to some imbalance or a very small change or a small neglect that has occurred in some ecosystem, we are bound to see this kind of consequences. Similarly, coming back to the topic, any small change or imbalance in mangrove ecosystem can also lead to irreversible damage, of which we are already like know what is happening around the world. Every year we see the flooding, we see sea level rise, we see climate change, and there are many such. So here are some questions that we need to think on, that what is it that mangroves have something to do with our lives? Like, why nature has created them? And maybe, like, I may sound completely irrational over here to say this, but I don't know, like, why this mangroves and this tiny virus is residing only in tropical and subtropical areas. I still don't know if there is any connection. But before you go into deep thinking and getting into solution finding mode for this little tiny mysterious coronavirus, I would again like to take you back to the beautiful mangrove areas that are seen along the Indian coastline. Oh, so where are we? This beautiful picture is from Middle Andamans. It is the place where you can see this big, huge mangrove trees with diversity of more than 44 mangrove species, pure, clean water, smooth transition of terrestrial and mangrove trees, beautiful sceneries, saltwater crocodile, and of course, a birding paradise too. The trees over here in Andaman are very strong and sturdy and giant and huge. Maybe like this is an island ecosystem and it has to face more natural extremes than the mangroves that are found near the boundaries of our countries. So maybe they are made in that way. Now, this is the photo of Dhani Nala Mangrove Nature Walk, which is the largest boardwalk of 712 meters in the country. Now, let me make you realize that we are on the virtual tour for the mangroves, where we will be visiting different places near India and see the glimpses of it. Now, oh, what are this? Have you seen them before? What are you thinking? What can this be? Can this be also the roots? But they are not looking like pointed pencil-like structures. But can you see some folds? These are the specialized breathing roots, just like the pencil-like roots, but they bend like as we bend our knee. So they are called as knee-like roots. And they bend repeatedly to form this wonderful pattern on the ground. And this type of roots are seen in some of the mangrove species and genera belonging to Bruguera and Ceriops. In Marathi, Bruguera is called as Jhumbar and Ceriops is called as Kirkiri. Now, this is Morisdera ecotourism. This is against the amidst the mangroves and big rocky structures. So there are this big rock structures in which, like, you know, there are only little bits of like wooden structures that are made, and there are some mangroves on the other side, and I'm sure this can definitely add a piece to your eyes. Now, can you guess from where this lovely shades forming dense green, muddy and dark blue landscapes are from? This type of pattern can be seen nowhere other than Sundarbans only, or the east coast of India. So about east coast of India, the very important thing in terms of mangrove growth is we have luxuriant and rich growing mangroves on the east coast. This is because of the deltas that are formed because of the river flow. Now, what are the deltas? So this is the land, or this is the sediment which is formed while these rivers are flowing. They are carrying the sediment, and that is deposited over here near the mouth where this sea will meet the Bay of Bengal. So in the Sundarbans, this mighty rivers like Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna, near the mouth of the Bay of Bengal where they enter, so they form this huge green patches of mangroves. And this is how the Sundarban mangrove forest will look like. And they will harbor this kind of trees with thick, dense canopies. There are more than 35 to 40 species that can be seen in the Sundarban forest. And Sundarbans are named after the trees that are called as Sundari. It forms the largest mangrove forest in the world, the single patch of mangrove forest. In a way, if we see the world mangroves, then Indonesia is the place where we get to see large patches of mangroves. But Sundarbans is one such forest where this one big huge patch is a mangrove area. And so it is also declared as a World Heritage Site by the international body UNESCO, and it is also a Ramsar site. Now, going further, what are this? I think you can guess this by now that these are the breathing roots. They are very thick compared to what we have seen earlier, the pencil-like roots. But that indicates that these roots belong to different species. So every species has its own identity. And 1 minute, can you see this tiny engineers over here? So here, apart from shredding the mangrove leaves, which is required in the food chain, but they also need to increase their strength. So can you see this camouflaged crab over here? That is the female. And this red color crabs having this one biggest claw, which is like a fiddler instrument, are the male fiddler crabs who are busy attracting their princess who is over here. Now princess has all right to take their exams and will be attracted only to the crab who is continuously, tirelessly waving at her for hours together. And by now you might have understood that even they have love stories. Now what are these beautiful lantern like structures? These are the flowers of one of the mangrove species called Rugvera. Rugvera is also called as Jhumbar. As you can see the flower, it looks like a jhumbar, like a chandelier. And I have also read it in the literature that the leaves of this Rugvera, they are used as a delicacy in many of the Indonesian cuisines. Going further, oh terrific, did you spot that? The resting salt water estuarine crocodile on the mud flats. So beware to roam fearlessly in this forest. These crocodiles can grow really giant and scare you to hell. What are they doing over here? They are the rhesus monkeys who can swim in the waters and probably the most flexible creatures of this forest. Now, this is how you can see the Sundarbans. It is the water world where one can roam mostly in the ferries and the boats. People in the Sundarban, they are very simple, nice, but they are extremely poor and highly dependent on the mangrove forest of the Sundarban. Their major income source is completely relied on the fishing and the honey collection. Now, to live here is not very easy as people have to risk their lives daily to earn handful income to feed their families. As we all know, Sundarbans is the only place in the world, like only the mangrove habitat in the world, which harbors the man-eating tigers. They can swim very well and they are wild hunters. Now many a times when people, like mostly the honey collectors, they enter the poor areas in search of honey, they either get trapped or they get bitten by the tiger or maybe many a times by the honeybees. So now since honey is the prime occupation in Sundarbans, they often risk their lives. Now, some of them are also turning into nature guides as they see some income coming from the ecotourism. So, this was little information about Sundarban mangrove forest. Going ahead, these are some birds from the Sundarban's mangrove forest. And going ahead, this picture is from Bhitarkanika mangrove forest. Now, what do you think after looking at this photo? Is this dark colored areas look like the mudflats? If you're thinking like that, then they are not mudflats. But what they are the seeds of one of the mangrove species, mostly the Sundari trees, that is Heritera foams, floating on the water. So it is very different what you see in the image and what you actually see in the forest. The forest has a lot of information to tell and to share with us. It too has the estuarine crocodiles, like being on East Coast, the deltas that are formed, they have a gradual slope, which makes the mangrove growth in this areas very luxuriant. Have you seen this board? Do you remember the logo of Kingfisher's airline? Yes, this is a Kingfisher. And it has been published in some of the research papers as well that all different seven types of kingfishers are visible or seen in the mangroves of Bhitarkanika. And so this is also called as Kingfisher's Paradise. Now there is one interesting concept over here. The concept is called as commensalism. Now, commensalism means what? Like the big hunters, like the crocodiles and maybe the otters. So whenever they chase other wild animals and all, so that is the time these birds and all, they grab the food and they catch the food. So that methodology of catching food is referred as commensalism. Now, this was about the Bhitarkanika mangrove forest, and there is one more image that I would like to share. This is also of the Sundari trees. Now, this Sundari trees, this photo is clicked from the west coast from the Sindhudurg area. This is the sacred grove called Killaniuti. This is a very small area which has around 39 to 50 trees growing in this area. Now, many a times, like, you know, it is only because of people, these type of ecosystems are protected. So having been this being a sacred grove, maybe, like, you know, the species would have not existed today. It is only a decade back or so we got to know about this beautiful and pristine rare species that grows on the west coast of India. What are these? Oh, they are taller than us. So these are again the pencil-like roots, and these roots can grow taller, like more than 7 to 8 feet tall. And these roots can be seen in a species which is called as chippy or Sonoracea cassiolaris. This is called as lal chippy, and this is a place or a village near Karli River in Sindhudurg, where there is village which is named as named after Chippy. So in this village near the river, we often get to see this species. This is a very rare species that is again found on the coastline of Maharashtra. Oh, what are these beautiful birds? So these birds that you can see over here, these are called as northern shovelers. Now, this being a season of migratory birds, like many years start migrating in over here in winters, and these are northern shovelers. They have migrated from other countries to our very near Thane tree. Then this is another photo of northern shoveler, the same bird which you saw in the flight. These are the flamingos. Flamingo is the key species of the Thane Creek, and Thane Creek is one of the sanctuary which is being loved and which is visited by many people across, and it is becoming very popular day by day because of its huge congregation of these flamingos. Now, as you can see in the image, can you see this canopies? So these canopies are of the one species called Avicennia marina. So now, this being a Mumbai area, this is the highly saline area, and many a times, like, it has been found that the species diversity will usually change based on the salinity of that area and also other factors like pollution and all. So this particular species is highly resilient to the pollution and the salinity changes or the fluctuations, and probably that is the reason that all the entire Thane Creek and the nearby Mumbai and Navi Mumbai areas, we get to see this species in very good numbers. Now, this is a beautiful photo taken by a border in which you can see greater flamingo and lesser flamingo. Yes, these are the two species, key species that makes Thane Creek pink. That you can see here, you can see the difference in the beak, the difference in the eye, difference in the size. And yes, so all these pictures of Thane Creek was shared by the bird watchers on Thane Creek Flamingo Sanctuary website and the flamingo page. So these, they are the happy birders. So while we are watching this species, you can also see the harmony or kind of adaptation or acceptance between the wildlife, the humans, the urbanization, the green mangroves, making this place a very beautiful and unique. Now, coming back to where we started our discussion is, now do you recollect the food chain, the ecosystem that we discussed? Now, why these birds or why these creatures are attracted over here? The main reason behind is the food. There is a very good food availability, and they also provide good hiding and nesting areas for this species. And it is not only about flamingos or the tigers or the crocodiles that make this ecosystem unique, but then there are n number of places and n number of species which are endemic to certain areas. There are some turtle species, then there are otters, then there are fishing cats, and many other species that you will be mesmerized with after coming to the mangrove areas and after knowing them. And I hope I could give the justice to the virtual tour of mangroves. So stay tuned with us for further sessions and more such wonderful facts and insight of this beautiful ecosystem. So any questions?
Thank you so much, Sheetal. This was a wonderful trail you gave us, the tour of mangroves, virtual tour. Thank you for the tour. For the participant, I would like to tell you that in the more session of this app, you will have the option of raise hand. So if you have any queries or any questions, please raise your hand and the host will unmute you. And we will be taking first 5 to 6 questions for today on this online session. The further questions will be answered separately via email or via WhatsApp.
So I can read some of your questions in the chat box. So the scientific name of the Sundari tree is Heritera. There are two species of Sundari. One is Heritera litoralis and other is the Heritera holmes. Then Hemilata madam had asked that how many type of plants or trees are found in mangroves around India. So this is a very broad question in a way. Like if we consider about mangrove species, then there are around some 75 to 80 species of true mangroves. And apart from that, there are many associate mangrove species that can be found along. And I think a lot of studies are still going on that topic. To elaborate on anatomical details, we will need another session probably. But I think I can personally message you. You can just drop me an email where I can elaborate you about the anatomical details of the mangroves.
We will be taking the last question for today's session now. If you have any question, please raise your hand or put it in the chat box.
So I can read few more questions over here. Where somebody has mentioned that can we have access to all the mangrove batches and special permissions that are required. So that will depend on the area, and I think you can approach any of the nearby forest department, and I'm sure you will get a good assistance from them. Then there is one question from Amit. That has mangrove cell of Maharashtra been anytime successful in preventing damage to the mangroves of Mumbai? I would love to answer this question, but it is a very big story of how mangrove cell has played its role in conserving the mangroves. So definitely we will mail you the entire information.
Okay, now we will not be taking any further questions, and your questions will be answered separately after the session. Now I would like to request our executive director and APCCF Mangrove Cell, Mr. Virendra Tiwari, to share his few words about the today's session.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. First of all, I congratulate Dr. Sheetal and Saili Joshi and all other officers of the foundation who organized this webinar. And it was an excellent presentation by Dr. Sheetal. Even certain new things which I could learn from this. And I could see about 75 odd participants were there. And definitely it's a very good initiative started by Mangrove Foundation to organize such webinars during this period of corona pandemic. And one of the participants asked about the role of the mangrove cell in protection of the mangroves. So just in short, I would like to inform that roughly about 15,000 hectare area is declared as reserve forest after the year 2008 onwards. And these areas were earlier in charge of Revenue Department, which we have Forest Department has taken over about 14,000 hectare out of 15,000 hectare, and more areas which are still in possession of some of the municipal corporation and some other government organizations we are likely to take over. And the mangrove cell has also removed about more than 6,000 hutments which were constructed illegally on mangrove areas. And we have also employed Maharashtra Security Force Corporation guards to protect the area which are sensitive to encroachment and dumping. And there are many other initiatives which we are taking, which obviously we won't be able to elaborate here. And I once again congratulate Dr. Sheetal and my team members, and we should continue this efforts of creating awareness through this medium. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. We will definitely do more such awareness programs. Now I would like to request our joint director and DCF Mangrove Cell, Ms. Neenu Somraj, to share her thoughts.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Dr. Sheetal, thank you very much. It was really interesting presentation from your side. So I hope that there were like more than 70 participants were there, and they could see all these mangroves not only along the western coast but along the eastern coast. And you have already covered the biodiversity aspects of the mangroves and its some ecological as well as economic importance as well. So I congratulate you and thank you very much. So we expect more lectures on mangroves from you, especially on identification taxonomy parts. Thank you.
So, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. I thank our officials for sharing their thoughts and supporting us in this new initiative. Last but not the least, I would like to request all the participants to please subscribe us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. The handles you will be able to see on your screen. And I thank you all for joining us in this session, and we will update you about the upcoming session soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We have still 10 minutes to end this session. So if you have any questions, you can continue with the questions.
So there was this question on intangible benefits of mangrove. So all these other benefits is like, as we spoke about the carbon sequestration. So that is also an intangible benefit that we get from the mangroves, the land protection and all other things. And yes, I would like to share my contact details with you all. You can write on, can we send them a message over here?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
So I'm sharing
my email. You can share your email ID.
Yeah, I'm sharing my email address with you all. So if you have any questions or queries, you can write me anytime. Or I can also share you the number of Mangrove Foundation office. So I don't think right now the number is functional since we all are at home. But then later when we resume with our activities, you can also like contact us on that number.
Sheetal madam?
Yes.
There was one more question from Hemlata. How many types of plants or tree found in mangroves around India? Can
so, I think I answered this question. There are around, say it is spectacle. So we usually say that there are 60 species. Some of the research papers had mentioned about 70 to 80 different species of mangroves that are found on the coastline of, like worldwide, we can say, not only of India. Indian Sundarbans being the largest forest, like we, the Andaman forest that we have. So we have nearly more than 64 mangrove species in our mangrove areas. And apart from that, if we consider of associate mangrove species, then still a lot of studies are ongoing on this, that what all are the associate species. And there are many associate species, like more than 300 to 350 species are recorded till date.
Sheetal madam, there was one more one question is from Niket. What is the difference with inland mangrove species? Hello. Shital madam, hello. Can you hear us?
Hello, hello.
Yes, yes. Hi.
Yeah.
There is one question. Like, what is the difference with inland mangrove species?
I am not completely sure about the inland mangrove species, but definitely I would try to answer this question. So basically, the mangrove species are found in various areas. They are found near the coastlines. Then there are creeks and the estuaries, like, which grows more towards the landward side. So I think the more species that grow near the landward side are considered as the inland mangroves. But I will still check with this, and I'll reconfirm and get back to Mr. Niket.
Ma'am, there is one more question from Ronit. Is there any mangrove policies in India like as forest policies? Mangrove specific policies, I think he meant.
I think DCF ma'am or sir would be the right person to put on this. Yeah. Do we have them with us right now?
There are policies for mangrove conservation and protection, but details would be there on the
government
site.
I think mostly we use is the Environment Protection Act and the Wildlife Act, which are also applicable for the mangrove forest. And apart from that, the CRZ rules and criteria are being followed everywhere as far as the mangrove forest are concerned.
Madam, there is one more question from Krutika. She is asking, what is the survival rate of mangrove after plantation?
That is, like, you know, it depends on area to area. Like, whenever we do any kind of plantation, if it has a good water flow and the water quality, and also if if it gets that regular tidal flushing, then probably you will get a good survival rate. And survival rate will also depend on what kind of species that is planted. Supposingly, like, if you have planted some species which is not suitable for that particular habitat, then probably you will not get a good survival rate. So habitat study is very important. I have not touched that topic today, like, you know, which species can grow in which type of habitat. That is the different topic. But yes, the different type of species can be found in that habitat. That is all because of the kind of substrate and other environmental factors in that area.
Okay, now we will take last one question. We have only 2 minutes remaining. There is one question, dominant mangrove species in West Coast and East Coast. Can you give some details on that?
See, for West Coast, like, usually, like, if you read articles and all, like, it has always been said that Avicennia marina is the dominant mangrove species. But I differ with this because, like, you know, we have high fluctuations in the habitats as far as our coastlines are concerned. In Mumbai, if we see Avicennia marina is a dominant species, probably in Sundarbans you will see Rhizophora mucronata as a dominant species. So there are dominant species, but it can be one single species. It can be dominant to that particular area. And similar way will be applied to the East Coast as well.
Guys, we will end the meeting now. Time is running out. Thank you very much for everyone for participating. You can follow our social media platforms, and you can share your questions there also. And Shital madam has also shared her email address. You can write to her for any questions you have. Thank you very much.
Thank you.